tell us something about the Break Your Plexus. And we went through our seminar, just Break Your Plexus spine and kind of foot spine, and we will go back to Break Your Plexus, not to talk about it itself, but to talk about the branch of the Break Your Plexus, which is the suprascapular nerve. And why suprascapular nerve? Because it's, though it's relatively uncommon, but it's commonly missed. So I just talk about this and what the options for treatment of suprascapular nerve neuropathy. And here, before start with the nerve anatomy, just let us talk about this case and what's your opinion. What's wrong with this young patient? He's 17 years old, has right shoulder pain for more than 2 years. Onset was post-traumatic quad pain football, and he has pain increased with overhead activity, has abduction and external rotation weakness, and presented to me 2 years after failure of conservative treatment in form of multiple steroid injection and physical therapy. So what's wrong with him? For the first instance, you may say he has rotator cuff tear, and let's come back to him at the end of presentation. Now, basic anatomy, suprascapular nerve originate from the upper trunk of brachial plexus, and the main contribution is C5, C6, and it course and pass through the suprascapular notch under the transverse capillary ligament toward the arteries above, and it gives two branches to the supraspinatus muscle, and it traverses the supraspinous fossa and round, curve around the lateral edge of the spine of the scapula, and then pass to the infraspinatus, where it supplies the infraspinatus muscle. And during its course, it gives some sensory branches to the AC joint, glenohumeral capsule, and occasionally to skin posterior to the shoulder. So it has two contributions, motor and sensory. So we can predict that a patient with suprascapular nerve entrapment has some motor function, motor dysfunction, in terms of weakness and atrophy of supra and or infraspinatus, and he may have also pain. And this mainly depends on the site of entrapment. So where it can be? The size of entrapment can in the suprascapular notch, or it may be in the fossa or the spinal glenoid notch. And most of the time, in these two positions, it may be a result of a cyst or space-occupying lesion. So the presentation of patients with suprascapular nerve entrapment can depend on the site. So when it's proximal, there may be more pain, and it affects both the supra and infraspinatus muscle. While when it's more distal, it can cause less pain or sometimes painless wasting of the infraspinatus muscle. So what's the causes? It could be either primary idiopathic, we don't know why this happened, and it may be secondary to trauma, which may be direct trauma or indirect trauma, may result from traction injury, or nearby trauma, like trauma to the clavicle fracture or AC joint. And it could be a result of repetitive stress, which is traction compressive injury by some activities, which is most of the time sport related, like volleyball. And it may result from cyst or space occupying lesion, which most of the time in the either suprospinous fossa or in the spinal glenoid notch. And patient usually present with pain in the posterior shoulder, which is dull, achy in nature, and it worsens with overhead activity. And most of these patients complain of weakness, fatigue, and if he's a player, he's complaining of loss of endurance. And there may be history of trauma again. So by physical examination, see that the patient has wasting or atrophy of the supraspinatus and infraspinatus muscle. But here, I have to stress on that sometimes patient has atrophy of the supraspinatus muscle, which could not appear because it's under the trapezius. And okay, again, I ask the patient to do external rotation to see if there is some sort of scapular dyskinesia. If you see here, there's winging of the scapula, and this may be associated injury to long thoracic nerve. Again, there's tenderness. Sometimes you can elicit tenderness in the suprascapular notch, weakness on abduction and external rotation. But fortunately, most of these patients have preserved motion, unlike when there's rotator cuff pathology. there is a test described for this, which is the suprascapular nerve stretch test. And you take the head of the patient, lateral rotation to the other side away from the shoulder, and then you depress and retract the scapula. And if this elicits pain in the posterior shoulder, this may be a positive test. The diagnosis, sometimes difficult, and needs clinical suspicion. So whenever you see a patient with vague pain, weakness, has weakness of abduction external rotation, has atrophy of supra and infraspinous muscle, and you say, okay, this is, you see, or say this is a rotator cuff problem, but when MRI comes normal, so you have to think always with suprascapular nerve entrapment, and especially in patients with failed previous good surgery. So you have done, for example, decompression for a patient, and it was good surgery, and the patient still complaining. So what's wrong with this? You have to think with suprascapular nerve entrapment. And MRI may be normal. In the case of idiopathic, most of the time it's normal or may show just tendinopathy. MRI helpful to show if there is cyst, paralateral cyst, or space-occupying lesion compressing the nerve, and sometimes can show if there is muscle atrophy and the degree of atrophy and if there is associated fatty degeneration. Nerve conduction study and EMG is very helpful when positive, but negative result does not exclude the diagnosis. So it's diagnostic value when positive. Some diagnostic tests for local injection, and you can use the G portal. Excuse me, where is the point? So you can do some point of one. Just press. Okay, you can. Okay, point. Okay, you can do the test by through the G portal. In scope, we use some portals and name it, and this is the G portal, and you can go through this in clinic, not in, in theater, in clinic, and you can give injection using this portal, and the direction of the needle is posterior anterior, and you can inject 5 cc lidocaine, and after that you assess if the patient symptoms improve and he's getting relief of pain. This may be a positive test and it may be of diagnostic value, but some claim that even this injection can improve pain by other pathology other than suprascapular nerve entrapment. So the diagnosis sometimes is difficult. It makes it easy to have a positive nerve conduction study and EMG, but if not, it may be the diagnosis of clinical suspicion and diagnosis of exclusion. Now, how to manage this depends on many factors, like the cause of it, severity and duration, the degree of functional disability, and the patient preference. These are factors to be taken into consideration, and it's divided to non-operative and operative treatment. We always go first to non-operative treatment in if there is no lesion compressing the nerve, no cyst or no other space of point lesion compressing the nerve, so we go to non-operative treatment, and stress on physical therapy aiming for scapular stabilization and strengthening of the rotator cuff muscles. And this may be helped with local infiltration. But be aware that prolonged course of non-operative treatment can cause more atrophy and may worsen the outcome. So operative treatment indicated when there is space-occupying lesion or after failure of non-operative treatment or conservative treatment, especially in idiopathic cases. So we can operate either, depending on where the nerve is entrapped, either in the suprascapular notch or the spinal glenoid notch. In the spinal glenoid notch, most of the time it's a result of a cyst, and you can treat that either open or arthroscopic. And we'll talk about release at the suprascapular notch. We have two options, either open surgery, and I hope that Dr. Ashraf here, that we can discuss with him his experience with open surgery, because we thought and we believe that it has difficult access in terms of narrow field. You need to just light more bleeding, and you need assistance. And it goes through the trapezius muscle, and it has its consequences later, dropped shoulder and the healing of trapezius. And it's long surgery. You see here, it's narrow field, and usually the problem is with bleeding. And we prefer arthroscopic surgery. when you have experience, it's easier than open, it's even faster and it's more reliable. And by the same procedure, you can diagnose other pathology in the shoulder and you can deal with it once. So when to do suprascapular nerve release? Is it in only in isolated? No, there's too many talks about the its indication with massive retracted rotator cuff tear, and we have discussed that in this shoulder session. And also, sometimes you need to do that. You have good rotator cuff repair, and the patient is still complaining, and you do MRI, it's good repair, but still complaining. You have to think of that, and you may need to release the suprascapular nerve. Now back to our patient. So history, I told you. Now, on clinical examination, he has atrophy of post-supra-infraspinatus. He has a relatively unstable scapula, and he has weak abduction, external rotation, and tenderness in the suprascapular notch. MRI, the rotator cuff normal, and one cut it showed some tendinopathy. He has fluid at the collection at subcoracoid, here at subcoracoid, and extending medially, but not to the fossa. So I think it's non-relevant. And we have also, by nerve conduction and NG study, it showed an evidence of suprascapular nerve entrapment at the suprascapular notch. And in this patient specific, he has also signs of all axillary nerve injury, which is partially recovered. So this is the conclusion of the EMG study. And so the patient, in my eyes, he has suprascapular nerve entrapment. He's young, 17 years old, and severely complaining. So I did bought a management plan, and I excluded non-operative treatment because it's long history, 2 years, the patient has muscle atrophy and has failed previous conservative treatment. So I plan to do diagnostic arthroscopy to do suprascapular nerve release, and I stress on the, with the patient just before the operation, I stress on the importance of having an intensive post-operative program aiming to have scapular stabilization and strengthening of the muscle. So I went to surgery, this is positioning, I define the porters, and after that I start with the posterior porter to do glenohumeral arthroscopy to test the biceps, the rotator cuff, and I found really, I don't know how is this contribute to the patient's symptoms. I found synovitis here in the posterior part with the fraying of the labrum, like in patient with posterior impingement, but I couldn't find slab, it was only slab one, and stable. So I debride this and went after that. I did partial synovectomy and went after that to subacromial space. And surprisingly, it's normal. You see, this is the CA ligament and there's no fraying of the ligament. So I decided, sure, to do the suprascapular nerve. I think it's the cause. And went to pace of the CA ligament. And after that, this is the coracoclavicular ligament. And this is the medial border. When I reach this, I stop shaving and I use this retractor through the G porter and sometimes through the N porter to do a plant dissection because the artery is close and near nearby the suprascapular artery, and then I define the transverse scapular ligament, and here is the nerve. I put this rod and then shift it in this between the ligament and the nerve, and use this retractor to retract the nerve. And at this point, you need your assistant helping us to hold the retractor. So he can hold the retractor and you insert the scissor and then cut the nerve. And if you see after cutting the nerve, it's bulging. And I, at that time, I took deep breath and I said, okay, this is the reason. Okay, this is after the operation, and here show the portals where this is the G portal, N portal, and this is other portal used. And this is the patient 2 weeks after surgery. He had significant improvement regarding pain, but sure still has the weakness. And this is after 4 months, he relatively restored the muscle bulk, but still weak. And we know that these patients may need more than 1 year to restore the muscle bulk. And if we go to literature, we see that Lafos has described this technique first, and maybe he has 10 years experience with that, and he has good result, excellent good result in 90%. In the neuro literature, using the open technique, they have 77 degree, good to excellent result. When there is a cyst, the result is about 90%. and in the presence of a lesion in the spinal cord, not the excellent result in 90 to 93%. So by conclusion, suprascapular nerve dysfunction or entrapment is relatively uncommon, but can easily be missed. Diagnosis need high clinical suspicion. Think of it in patient with vague symptoms, spinatus muscle atrophy, failed previous treatment, and in patient with rotator cuff dysfunction after good repair. Negative nerve conduction study and EMG does not exclude the diagnosis. Arthroscopic suprascapular nerve release is a new surgery, but very efficient and reliable when you have experience. Thank you.